Thank you for tuning in to the Refuge Church YouTube channel. We pray that you're blessed by the message. Let's join the service already in progress.
Love has called my name. God, I am every chain, break every chain, to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. In the name of Jesus, there's an army rising up. To break every chain, 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 to break every chain. Hallelujah, hallelujah, the chains are broken, the chains are broken, the chains are broken, the chains are broken.
So did anybody think that we wouldn't make it to 2017? I mean, you know, you start looking at that. I was thinking this back. Go back when you were a kid, you know. You know how you got all exaggerated? Like, when I get older, I'm going to have like gazillion dollars, you know. And it's going to be, you know, you always said things. Yeah, well, it'll be like 2017. And because that's what you thought was crazy and absurd way out there. And now you're going, whoa, it's 2017. We're not wearing silver suits. We're not floating around. We're not. Remember all that? They always went, oh, like the Buck Rogers, you know, and all of a sudden. And yet here it is in 2017. I'm driving a Toyota that takes real gas, and there's real money that I got. What happened to that whole floating around? And well, we made it. We made it. And 2016, man, that was a year of challenges, right? Can we all agree? I mean, we're all in the same boat. I mean, every year that goes by, you can say that there's going to be some changes, right? Challenges, you know. But 2016 seems like it seriously had a score to settle with some folks, right? You seeing that? Man. But here we are, and it's the first. This is weird, isn't it? The first. Like, Christmas was on Sunday. The first is on Sunday. And we were talking about that with her crazy joke. But I started thinking about that. You wake up and you go, well, it's the first. Well, tomorrow is going to be the Rose Parade. And, you know, when's the Rose Bowl? Tomorrow. Oh, so that's all tomorrow. Everything's tomorrow. So here we are on the first, yet we're here. They're going to postpone it. And I kind of thought, well, yeah, whatever we got to do to get one more day. So, you know, last week on Christmas, I couldn't do that. But this one, okay, it's all right. We can move that. So here we are on the first, and we're starting this out where you kind of go into this new year. And, you know, you're taking the 2016 and you're just kind of ripping them off and just, maybe some of us might even be throwing them in the fire. But you get to that point where you got January 2017. Brand new. Nothing on there. Nothing on there. Nothing written. Nothing put together. And you see that this is something to start. It's a brand new start. And I think that's what we look for. I think that's kind of the thing that's in us. It's the very first day that not one human being has any input on what's coming. I mean, you don't have any idea. You don't know what's going to happen. There's choices that have not been made yet. And nothing has been decided. Your choices are all out there in front of you. And we can choose whatever we like. This is our choices. This is the very definition of love. When it says God is love. Love, being agape, is charity. We went through this. And charity being giving. It's a choice. So when we love God, it's a choice. It's not a feeling. It's not an emotion. It's not any of that stuff like humans. So when we look at these choices that we've got in front of us, this is what God gave us. He loves us so much, he said, I want you to choose. I want you to choose. I want you to be able to do that. So this year that's in front of us is set up just like that. Now the past, it's the past. Everything that was in 2016, there's not a dang thing you can do about it. Not a dang thing you can do about it. And the enemy tries to creep in and tries to hang this need or requirement to pay some kind of penance over the things that occurred in the past. Man, I screwed up. I can't believe I did that. And all of a sudden, you're dragging it around like it's a weight around your neck. Like, oh, I made some mistakes, and I can't believe that. And you're just dragging that along as though, because you're going to make you say, well, I got to feel bad over this. You know what I mean? The understanding that we have from Romans 7 is where sin is not us. It's the sin that is in us. The us, the born again us, it doesn't sin. It's that flesh that's in there. When that sin occurs in our lives, we turn that over to God and keep walking. We stop being sin conscious and start being life conscious. But the flesh and the enemy still tries to keep going, yeah, I know that's what they're saying, and I know that's what you think you read in the Bible, but you don't know how bad you screwed up. You need to carry this weight around a little more, you know? Kind of like that crawling around on your knees, a couple religions makes you go do something crazy because you got to pay some penance here. But all that does, if you ever did get past it, would make you go, I paid my dues, which is not true. The sin that has occurred, it's gone. Everything that was in 2016 where we screwed up, it's gone. And the only thing that matters is today. This is what we're dealing with today. And it's a fresh new season. The Bible speaks about ending the old and beginning the new in many places, in all different kinds of ways. Ending the old and going into a new season. And when we were created by Father, human beings. When human beings were created by Father, we were created to require changes. We were required to have seasons that shifted, cycles, if you want to look at them as cycles. We need change. We need seasons. And he did this for many reasons, many of them. The very first, if you look up season, you know how there's there's a thing in the Bible, when you're talking about learning the Bible, there's a thing called the law of first mention. Anytime that something is mentioned for the first time, it's got some significance to it. I think the first time that shoes are mentioned are when they're talking about Exodus, when their shoes didn't wear out. First time love is mentioned, it was when he was talking about Abraham loved his son and he had to sacrifice. So the first time that season is mentioned is in Genesis 1:14. And it's talking about in the very beginning with Adam and Eve. And it says, that, and then God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and seasons and for days and years. See, we've got a time for work, activities, you know, when you go do things, and that's the daytime. And then there's a time that we rest, a time that we unwind, a time that we recuperate. That's the evening time. Then we've got weeks is a cycle. There are 6 days that we work in that day-night cycle. And then there is a seventh day that we rest. So it changes a season so that we can begin that cycle again. That's 6 days, and then the seventh day we rested. We're all very familiar with, thank God it's Friday, right? And we're even more familiar with, oh man, it's Monday, because we get used to that cycle. So when Friday is coming up, you're going, whew, weekend's coming. What are you going to do? I don't know, but it ain't going to be working. And then by Sunday afternoon, you're going, oh man, I got to get up in the morning. So that cycle starts to set in. That's the weekly cycle. Now these week cycles, they add up into month cycles. All of creation is aware of monthly cycles, some more than others. The moon's monthly cycle affects the gravity on the earth. And I've always been of the belief that the earth is 2/3 water. I don't know if you knew this, but human beings are 2/3 water. So that same gravity that is pulling against the earth and causing these tidal shifts and things like that, it also changes things in human beings. I do not mean they turn into werewolves, but they do affect it. As a matter of fact, it's not even hard to see. You go out and, you know, look at some people and you'll see some changes. You know, there must be a full moon now, you know, craziness. But the Hebrew calendar is based on that monthly lunar cycle, which happens to be much more accurate than the solar. We follow, when we say 2017, that comes out of the Gregorian calendar. That's a solar calendar. That's something that the Romans did, and then it got put on us, and we adapted it, much like we did the alphabet, Latin alphabet. So that lunar cycle is what divides the months when it comes to the Hebrews. Now, these months add up into seasons. See, spring, it's beautiful. Fresh, it's new, things are coming alive again from being asleep, and you can see them starting to sprout and blossom. Then summer comes, and it gets warmer, and it's a time for work, it's a time for, you know, preparation, getting things ready, you know, summer, you know, you're planting and you're doing the things that you need to do. Then it rolls into fall, and fall has a special feeling to it. I don't know about you guys, but every time it comes around to October, there's a weird feeling in the air. And I don't think that it's not a coincidence, because that happens to be the same time that we see like Rosh Hashanah. You know, that is literally the new year of the Hebrew calendar. It happens to also be where the feasts were. And coincidentally, where there's smoke, there's fire, it happens to be where the dark side, the occult, chooses to put its high days, where they get involved in the occult practices. That's where you see Halloween come in. So that I think that is a very significant, the fall. But it's also a time when things prepare to sleep. It's when things kind of get ready to close up. Animals hibernate. Even plants start to go dormant. The green thumb that I do not possess, I've been able to watch around our place as my wife plants things, and I try to help as much as I can. She tells me to get away from them, but
when I see something and it looks like it's dead, I'm going to start yanking them up. And she goes, whoa, it ain't dead. It's just, you know, it's asleep. And I'm like, yeah, whatever, you know. And what happens in spring? Well, I go back out there and it's green and starting to grow again. I go, oh, I guess you're right. So even plants, they start to go to sleep. They start to shut down. They start to. So we do our thing, right? You winterize your house. You know, you fill in the cracks so no wind gets in. You fix the heaters. And so we do all that kind of stuff. And that's what fall does, getting ready for that coming winter. And winter is when everything either dies or goes to sleep until that spring arrives when that life comes back. So you see these seasons. You see these things. And they're not accidental. These are absolutely a creation design. They're part of creation on purpose. And there's way more than the obvious ones. I think you could even take that thing I'm doing and make it bigger, bigger. I think you can even pick up things in life. I think there's a life cycle. You can see a person that goes through a cycle in life. But we were created to require these changes, cycles, seasons, and we look forward to the transition from one to the other. You look forward to that transition. Even children, at the end of summer, when it comes time for school, they're actually excited. They're actually excited. They want to go back to school because they've been doing this for so long, getting up, playing, doing whatever, and now they're going to go back to school. But now you go in school long enough, they're going to be really excited to get out of school. So this change happens early in a human being's life. You can see this kind of thing, whether it's day to night. It starts to get to the end of the day, and you're like, yeah, go home, get some dinner, relax, rest, get some sleep. And then you get up, and you're like, all right, time to get up, time to get going. So even the day-night one does it. Friday at 5 o'clock, you're like, all right, time to go. And I know everybody's Friday, and everybody's 5 o'clock's different. Some people's are, you know, Saturdays, and some people's got them in the middle of the week. But you get it when that time comes, when your rest comes. Or even the close of a month. You see the end of the month coming. And we see it because there's business things that happen. But there's other stuff that starts to happen. Like, oh, the rent is due, a negative thing that you're looking at. You know, got to take care of this responsibility. Or there's other things that just keep shifting. The year starts to shift. And this is where you see all the either radio programs, TV shows, all over YouTube. A year of 2016, you know. And typically we see all the people that we've lost, you know, in 2016. And I kind of look at it and I go, yeah, those people are famous. I mean, and we all know who one or the other of them are. But there was other things that happened during the year too. And you just kind of look at that. How about the good things that happened? Nobody ever said, hey, look at all these great things that happened, because we're always kind of, the news anyway, is always kind of focused on the negative. Now, the human requirement for change, it really becomes evident in our daily activities. See, when you walk over to somebody, tell me if this sounds familiar. You walk over to somebody and you go, hey, what do you want to eat? What's the first thing you're going to get? I don't know. That's what you get. I don't know. And then you go, okay, come on, let's figure out something. Okay, well, let's get something good, right? These are the same patterns, because you want something different than what you've been having. Let's get something good. So, you know, I've done enough of this. Let's get something different. Let's go over to do, because you're used to that. Wow, you moved the furniture. Yeah, I needed a change. I don't know, do you guys move the furniture around in your house? Do you? You probably do it all the time, don't you? Are you getting used to that? Mark just goes, leave it alone, sits right there. Sydney goes, no, I'm going to strap it to the ceiling tomorrow. We're going to do something different. It's always going somewhere else. And for the record, Mark does not like Christmas trees. No Christmas trees. So we go through changes with all this stuff. I went through a house where they didn't move it too much, but once in a while they changed it. So I'd move stuff around. And luckily, she'll put up with my moving it around. I put the bed one time over in this little alcove where it had windows all the way around it, and we put up with it for about 30 days, but that wasn't going to work. So we just needed a change, right? Like, for example, you go by, we talk about this all the time, why do they got to build a new mall? I have been shopping at the Central City Mall since I was a kid. Does anybody know where the Central City Mall is? Okay, three old people know exactly where it is. Okay, all right, the rest of you just got honest. So I said that the other day, and some kid goes, Central City what? And I went, oh, that's not good. So it turned into the Carousel Mall, which was its demise, and then all of a sudden we had the Inland Center Mall. That's where everybody's going to go, they're going to the Inland Center Mall. So they redid the Inland Center Mall, so we're all going down there. But then all of a sudden we had to redo these ones over here towards Redlands, and now we're going over there. Why do we do that? Oh, because it needs an update. Because people want change. They want something new. They want to see something new. That's why do car manufacturers keep coming up with a new model? You realize, I work on cars. You realize most of the time these cars, for the most part, they're exactly the same as they were the year before. They will do something really goofy, like they'll put a line where they didn't have a line, or they'll put a different pattern of seat. And then once in a while, they'll change them drastically. But you'll see people, I've got to go get the new model. You realize it's the exact same car as it was last year. Yeah, but I've got to have a new model. All right. It's built into us, right? And we see it, music, food, clothes, right? Wide ties, skinny ties, no ties. What is it? So, oh, don't get me started with cell phones. I dropped my phone. You have an iPhone 7, right? Gotta have it. I dropped mine, and it smashed into a gazillion pieces, and I'm the guy that almost tries to, on purpose, not go get the new thing. And then I find myself going out in public going, hey, I'm looking for one of these. And they look at me and they go, you're kidding, right? I went to get a case for her phone for Christmas. Because she said, I don't want a new phone. Don't you get me a new phone. So I went to go get a case. And I said, oh, she's got this phone. It's a 4. It's an iPhone 4. Are you Apple people familiar with what iPhone 4 is? Moses had an iPhone 4. Right? So did you get the look? So I went over there, I said, I just need to get a case. He looked at me like, dude. So I went and got one online. Where do you think I got it? Amazon. No, the case actually we got in the mall, didn't we? That's right, we got the case in the mall. All right, so all these things keep changing. Now, in the past, I spoke about cycles. You guys remember that? We were talking about cycles, where humans actually were in bondage, and then there's kind of a set free to us. And this actually was done by Tyler back in the 1800s. And he did this, it was a cycle of nations. And these nations will go through these periods. But the problem is, it was a continuous cycle. It's an infinite cycle. It keeps doing the same thing over and over. That was the point I was making back then, is we need to break that cycle. It doesn't matter if it's groups, if it's nations, whole like big groups like nations, or if it's just people as individuals. The unhealthy thing about that cycle is when it just kept going in the same cycle. I went from good to bad, to get better, to turn it around, back to good, and it just keeps going. That's the cycle that we keep going in. And while seasons are a design feature of creation, they have a purpose, a very specific purpose. Its purpose is not to repeat over and over. These cycles are not so that we go spring, summer, fall, winter, spring, summer. It's not just so that we keep doing the same thing every year over and over. These things for us as new creations are to have that cycle, but what it does is we increase every time that cycle goes around, and it's more of a spiral upward. We do go through the cycle. There are the challenges. There are the night seasons, but these things are supposed to be there in a way that we grow. That was the purpose of these seasons and changes, was that we grow. So you could say, where I was last year, I'm not there now. Where I was two cycles ago, I'm not there now. Because you continually grow. That's the purpose. It's supposed to be more of an upward spiral. Now, we all agreed that in 2016, there's full of challenges. Full of challenges. And I got to tell you, we were talking about the same thing this morning. And how did you view those things? And Tammy said, well, let me share something. I look at that with all of the stuff that I went through, and if you're even remotely familiar with what she's been through, it was challenging would be a very good word. And she said, well, I look back at them, and I say, those were good for me. And, of course, people go, well, you're nuts. She said, I learned something. I learned something, and I grew from them, which then would take us as believers, we know James, right? 1:2-4, everybody's got to remember it. My brethren, count it all joy. That Greek term right there says throw a party. So my brethren, throw a party when you fall into various trials. Yeah, right. Because that's the negative side. That's the really, are you kidding me? When you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. That's why the trials, that's why the challenges are there. See, it was in those night seasons of that 2016 cycle that God expected us as believers to stand in trust and faith and count it all joy. It is the challenges that were allowed to enter into our life. Remember this. We serve the, not a, Almighty God. There is not more power anywhere. He does not possess power. He is power. He is light. He is peace. He is everything that is positive. So there is nothing higher than Him. Everything that is subservient to Him. I know that sounds like duh, but follow me. That means everything that happens here on the earth, does it happen without His knowledge? No. Does it happen without Him allowing it? No. Because if He wanted to stop it, He certainly could stop it. So, with the enemy hating us, despising us, wanting to destroy us, looking for every possible way to kill and steal and destroy us, then Father is involved in a believer's life. In a non-believer's life, there's nothing He can do. They're not calling on the name of the Lord. But in a believer's life, Father then is involved in that believer's life, and these challenges are Father-filtered. So as these challenges land, they are for the exact intent purpose that Tammy said. They're to cause us where we learn something, cause us where we grow, cause us where we can equip ourselves to be stronger, walk more in faith. That's what these things are for. And when we come out of a year, like 2016 with that kind of thinking, we may have some cuts and bruises. You may have some marks of battle. Look at anything that is used. Look at a warrior's sword. It's going to have nicks. It's going to have some marks in it. That shield, oh, it's certainly going to have some chunks taken out of it. It's certainly going to have some marks all over it because that thing has been used. That Bible, it better have some dog-eared pages. It better have those knees on your jeans. They better have some worn-out spots from some prayer that you've been in. So coming out of 2016, you're going to have some of that. But the one thing that you're going to have is you're going to have a smile that proclaims to everybody that's around that joy and that peace that the Lord reigns in your life. You're going to come out of something like 2016 where, yeah, you know, we got into some scuffles, but when we came out, that peace just comes out of you. There's a spirit about you. And that speaks of victory over 2016. And the experience of God's faithfulness that makes us say to the coming 2017, bring it on. You want some of this? Bring it on. We're not walking around with some kind of a skittish, oh my gosh, gee, I hope it's better. I mean, you almost sound like Eeyore from Winnie the Pooh, you know? It's just, oh well, whatever. Things are gonna, did I do another one, an old one? Anybody know who Winnie the Pooh is? Okay, good, at least we're all there. So Eeyore was the one that just, he was always bumming out. Well, this is what happens. But when you come out of 2016 and you come out with the kind of attitude that Tammy's got, where you look back and you go, you know what? It was good. I learned some things. Yeah, it was a little rough. I have some rough spots in there. But you know what? I came out of it with knowledge. I came out of it with wisdom. I came out of it with understanding. And you know what else I came out of it with? I came out of it with knowing that God answers prayer. I'm telling you that there were times in 2016 where I said, Lord, I really don't have any idea how this is going to work out. I don't see with my natural eyes how this is going to get taken care of with that. I don't understand that. And you turn it over to Him, stop trying to do it yourself, you relinquish that, you die to that kind of thinking, and you say, you know what, Lord? It's yours. And I know that I know that I know that you're going to answer this. The same way that you split a Red Sea for some guys that were getting ready to get killed, the same way that a giant lost his head because you were with David, and I know you're going to take care of this. And some time goes by. This is why you should have a prayer journal. I don't know if you guys do that, but you should have a prayer journal. Some specific thing you were praying about, you write it down and put a date. And then when that thing gets solved, when that answer comes, when that prayer and that petition gets answered, you go back and you write it down. You say, this is what God did, and this is the date. And what you're going to start seeing is God's always faithful. God never fails. God never fails. I don't care what the situation is. I don't care what the drama was. I don't care. Two human beings that are absolutely not getting along and things are blowing up, because all of our stuff can basically be boiled down into a couple different things. Finances, relationships, and personal health, your health, health of a human being. For the most part, all of our stuff can get boiled down into those. So health, God, heal this body. I've seen kidney stones disappear off of an x-ray, personally. They said I had them and then I didn't have them. So I keep giving those over to them, consistently. I've got four of them right now, so I'm consistently turning those over. But the mind, how about the mind? You start losing it. Lord, I just think I'm going crazy. I mean, I literally just start thinking, I'm going nuts. What's going on with it? And you know what? Lord, I'm just turning this over to you, and the peace will start reigning. And all through 2016, all these things that popped up, you said, Lord, I'm turning this over. You had more faith that he was going to take care of this than you did the last one, because he did the last one. And then this one over here, because you knew he solved this one, that those two people, that there's no way you'd ever be able to sort that out, God sorted that out, and now you're saying, well, I know this one. And then pretty soon people are coming over and going, hey, can you pray for me? I know he's going to do that. So all these things in 2016 that kept coming up, and you kept handing them over, and you kept saying, God, this is it. God, turn it over. All these things are going to make us be able to walk into 2017. And walking into 2017, you're going to have that faith that comes from chopping the head of that giant off that was just unspeakable, that the entire army wouldn't go for. And you're going to walk into 2017 and say, no problem. I know who I am. I know what I'm connected to. Now, speaking of seasons, right? The one that always comes to mind. When I say seasons in the Bible, what verse pops up to you? Which one? Genesis 8. What's that one? Oh, okay. All right. That's a good one. Anybody ever think of Solomon? Yep, Ecclesiastes. That's it. She did a Bible study, and as we were going through it, that just kind of stuck in my head for a long time. There's a season for everything. That means this is the Father filter. There is a season for everything. There is a time that the trial will come. Absolutely. And there is a time that the trial will be overcome by you. And then there's a time of rejoicing. There's a time to dance. And then there's a time to prepare, because there's more trials that are coming. The verse is Ecclesiastes 3:1. He said, to everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. Is God in control? He absolutely is. See, the enemy wants us to start getting this kind of a mentality that we serve a God that's capricious. He just does what he wants, when he wants. There's nothing to say that he's going to do anything exactly like this, because you just never know what he's going to do. Pastor used to say, hope so, maybe so. You never know what God's going to do. Well, that's not true, because his word is very specific, and his word never fails. And you can't find one thing that's ever failed, and you can't find one thing in your life that you've ever given to him that has ever failed. So we will have these seasons of rejoicing where we're just going, man, this is great. This is so awesome, man. I mean, things are just popping, man. God is taking care of us. We will have those times, but they will only come after we have faith through the night seasons. They are going to come. Do not look at night seasons like, oh boy, I'm just going through it. Because then you are looking at that like it is a negative, and you are not looking at it like count it all joy when we head into night seasons. And we can only stand in those faith in those night seasons when we have taken the season to prepare for the night season. You have to. What do the bears do? What do the squirrels do? What do the birds do? they prepare for the winter. They put away what they need to put away. They prepare the place that they're going to be staying for the time that it's going to be frozen. So we should always be in that mode of preparation. How do you prepare? You get His word written on your heart. I've always said, and I know it's drastic and it sounds like, you know, Mad Max or something, but I think you should be memorizing as much scripture as you possibly can. What if one day something happened and you couldn't have a Bible? I heard stories about the Chinese folks, and they all had memorized certain sections of scripture, and you put enough of them together and you had like a whole chapter because everybody had memorized something of it. And I thought, that's pretty good. That's the memorizing it and putting it on your heart. Well, we need to prepare because you're not always going to be, when the challenge comes, when the night season is there, you don't always have your Bible there. You might be walking down the street. You might be in your car doing something. If that word is in there, you can call that word up because it's written on your heart. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. This is what he's telling him to do. This is the preparation. This is what I want you to do for yourself, and because you are going to be a leader and a teacher of men, I want you to do this for other people. This is the preparation. Then Paul went and actually told believers himself in Galatians 6:9. He said, and let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. See, too many times we have taken these scriptures and we've eliminated the conditional words in them just so that they come to us no matter if I do anything or not. If, for in due season we shall reap, period. See, we can't lose heart. When you go through the 2016s of life and you go through those night seasons and the dark times, you have to go through there and not lose heart. You have to go through there and stand in faith. You have to go through there knowing that God is who He said He is, and God is going to do what He said He's going to do, and you don't blink, you don't flinch, you don't back up. You know that He's going to do it. And what happens? He does it. What moves God is faith. What moves God is when you are just unconditionally, unshakably trusting Him. And He says, I'm going to honor that. I'm going to honor that. What is faith? The evidence of things that are hoped for. Don't you hope for that healing in your body? We have aches and pains. Am I right? How about this? Is there anybody here that does not have aches and pains? I mean, in the back of my head, I'm looking at you guys, and I can tell you I almost know all of them, or a lot of them anyway, and it's making me think, this is where we go, the evidence of things hoped for. I sure hope I could get rid of this. That is my hope. It's not a throw it up in the air hope. It is a, I have my hope in God that this is going to go. Okay? And then finish the verse. The evidence of things hoped for. Oh, I'm sorry. Hope is. Faith is. Say it again.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not
seen. Evidence of things not seen. You don't see it yet. But you keep standing there and you keep saying, God's going to take care of this. I'm not going to worry about it. Apply that to your finances. Is there an issue in finances? Apply that to relational issues. You got some of those? Apply that to, you can see the list. Apply that to these things because this is what we're hoping for. Is it here yet? No. What does the world say? Believe what you see. God says, trust me, whether you see it or not. So this is where He's telling us not to lose heart. Walk this out. Now, however you exited 2016, however it was that you exited that, the result that you got was directly connected to your connection to Father and His Word. However you exited 2016, the result that you exited with is connected to your relationship, your connection with God and His Word. Now, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. God, a father said that He's going to allow challenges to come. We know that. And He will never allow something that will destroy us, right? The verse for that is 1 Corinthians 10:13. Quoted a lot. No temptation has overtaken you, except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. Didn't it just say that we will reap in a season if we do not lose heart? So he's saying that you will be able to bear it. That verse does not say that you will be able to just sail through it. That verse does not say that it might be a little uncomfortable. That's not what that verse says. It says that along with the challenge that he gives us, that he will make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. You will be able to get through it. It will not destroy you, but it will not destroy you because of the way of escape that he provides. If you do not take the way of escape that it provides, you're at the mercy of the challenge. You are not counting it all joy. You are not walking this through so that you can endure it and bear it. If you are going through it and you are saying, I'm going to take that way of escape, then I will be able to bear it. It won't destroy me. See, the way of escape that God has provided is, first off, being born again. These same things from the enemy that come in as attack, they hit the non-believers too. The rain falls on the just and the unjust. So these things that come down on the non-believer, they're going to try to go through it by their own will. They're going to try to pull themselves up by their own bootstraps. They're going to go into their positive confession, positive thinking mode, whatever it is that they do. Or they're going to go to whatever substance dulls the pain, whatever they do. But those same trials, they will also come to the believer, filtered through Father. And that is when he will provide this way of escape. So the second thing, being born again, means you're one with him and everything that he is. But that you comprehend what that means. See, being born again is one thing, and that's true. But he provides the way of escape. The trial comes down, let's just say finances. The trial comes down and is the finances. And you go, oh, woe is me. And you go, oh, my gosh, what's going to happen? Oh, my goodness, I'm not going to get this bill paid. Oh, can you believe this? Oh, I better put a GoFundMe together so somebody can give me money so I can go put this. Right? This is what happens. That person hasn't comprehended what it means to be one with God. He hasn't put together, he hasn't comprehended, he hasn't understood what it means to be one with everything that he is, who you are, and what the resources that you have available to you. Your name just got put on God's bank account to write checks. You see what I'm saying? This understanding is when you realize what it means to be a son. This is the same thing when people say, oh, I know Jesus. Oh, I believe in God. There's a difference in believing God, like I believe that JCPenney's is going to have a sale next week, and believing meaning comprehending what God did when he died on the cross. So that's the difference in somebody says, I know God, somebody's actually a born-again believer. Now the born-again believer says, oh, yeah, I believe in God. I believe in his word. And a person that goes, I understand what it says that a new believer has. A born-again believer being one with him is the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We don't have the righteousness of God. We are the righteousness of God. The people that we are today never existed before we were born again. You're brand new. Never existed before. Never, ever existed before. And when you grasp that, when you control that thinking and you can comprehend it, you can now go, this financial issue that comes up, you can, without blinking an eye, say, Father, I'm turning this over to you. I know, according to your word, that all finances are yours. Everything is yours. So how you take care of this bill is going to take care of this financial thing, but it's also going to increase my faith watching you work, watching all that work through me. That's how this understanding starts to occur. See, this is when we start saying in those night seasons that we are unshakable on the foundation that's being built that is of Jesus Christ. When I'm on that foundation, then we can say to the challenge that's in front of you, be still. The storm arises, and you say, be still. You don't say, oh boy, I sure hope this works. Abracadabra. You know that you know that you know who you are, and you say, be still. The attack of the enemy starts to come up, and you know it's an attack of the enemy. And you look over at it, and you say, be gone. What did Jesus say? Get behind me. That's the end of it. No long, drawn out, just get behind me. I know the authority that I have. You know more than you know your own name. That Father God is an infinite, absolutely infinite in power and in authority. Everything is going to bow the knee to the name of Jesus Christ. Everything, everything in creation is going to. There is nothing higher in authority. There's nothing more in power. And the power and the authority that he has is limitless. It's infinite. So when we know that, we read Psalm 145 in a different light. Psalm 145, 13 says, your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord upholds all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look expectantly to you, God, and you, God, give them their food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Everything comes from God, and everything is looking at God to see how this is going to happen in the right time, in the right place. Seasons. Verse 17, the Lord is righteous in all his ways, gracious in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. See, there's a difference in people that go, oh, Lord, save me, only because it was the last resort and their fingers are slipping off the edge of the cliff. There's a difference in that and a difference of a person who says, I'm putting my faith and my trust in him. That's my heart making a decision, not my emotions saying, oh, Lord, I'm now going to put my pride down, but it's only out of fear. Verse 19, he will fulfill the desire of those who fear him. He also will hear their cry and save them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all of the wicked he will destroy. See, it doesn't shake us. When these circumstances start to come, and these circumstances start to, like the stuff that we saw in 2016, it can't shake us. What we see, what we hear, and what we feel, it does not alter what we know, what we absolutely know. We love the season of preparation because we know that it is what is going to get us through the night season that comes. And we love, and the night season does not shake us because there's coming a season of rejoicing. When you look at these seasons like that upward spiral, you look at them as the steps in a staircase or on an escalator. You know, you have to have those to be able to go up there. If you didn't have these steps, you'd never get to the next level. You have to pick up your feet, make the steps. We got to be a stepper. I know of many believers in 2016, they didn't fare so well. They didn't fare so well. That spiral, it wasn't even really level. It was a downward spiral. You know, the choices that were being made, the places that they were putting their trust in, the things that they were doing, it was emotionally driven, it was physically driven, the flesh was driving it. They weren't prepared for the spiritual battle. They did not call on the name of the Lord. And these physical things affected them very negatively in the body, in the mind, and in the spirit. It affected them very negatively. Now think of this. Peter would have drowned in that water if he had not called on the name of the Lord, right? He would have stayed under water. So sinking into the water is not the failure. Sinking into the water wasn't a failure. Not getting out of the boat would have been a failure. Not calling on Jesus when we are sinking is a failure. It is not about us living successfully. It is about us dying and about Jesus living successfully in us. Our old self dying is what's going to bring victory because we're getting out of the way so that God can live inside us. And when Jesus starts to live inside us, we can start seeing these victories, these steps are becoming something that's second nature. That is what makes it possible to stand and keep on standing and put on that armor of God. Because as long as there are humans that need to be perfected, there are going to be seasons that'll come. That is what these seasons are for. To challenge us, to cause us to grow, so that we can rejoice and rest and to continue to prepare for the next season. This is what we do. Now, whether you came out of 2016 in victory or defeated, today is the day of transition from one season to a better one. Today is the transition. It doesn't make any difference that 2016 is from the solar calendar. This is the year that man in the West, anyway, has taken this calendar, and this is the day that we change. This is the day we go, Happy New Year. I held the door open for a guy, and instead of saying thank you, he said, Happy New Year. This is something that everybody is just driven. Okay, if this is where we're at, then this is where we're at. This is the transition of that one season to a better season. But you've got to make the conscious choice to enter this battle prepared. The Word of God works if you work the Word. That Word has got to be in there, it's got to be knowledgeable, and it's got to work. When the night seasons of 2017 arrive, you remember what God did in 2016. And just like the Jews consistently go back to the time that God brought them out of Egypt. Over and over, they talk about it. Our fathers. God brought our fathers out of Egypt. And that is what they stood on. That is what the faith that they have stood on to endure everything that Jews have endured through history is because they kept looking back on that. He was faithful and he got us out of Egypt and he got us through that desert, he got us through that Red Sea, and he'll do it again. And whatever he did for you in the past, he's going to do it again. And it's going to increase the more that we turn it over. First, we've got to realize that there is a real battle that is not in the physical, but it affects physical things. You go in and talk to your boss or whatever the situation might be, and they come unglued on you. That is very physical. They are in your grill about something. That is very physical. That situation is a fruit or a product of the battle that you can't see. That is the spiritual producing an effect in the physical. Your battle is not to go punch him in the nose. Your battle is to go and do battle in the spirit. Then it changes the physical. The enemy wants you to fight that battle in the physical and don't do anything about the spiritual. He wants you to roll up in a ball and cry because you got yelled at by your boss, because then you'll be so emotionally controlled you won't even consider praying. You won't even consider talking to God. You won't even consider getting into your Bible. All you want to do is roll up in a ball, cover your head up with a blanket, and cry. That's what he wants you to do, because the physical changed you. You need to do it the other way around. When the physical comes and does something to you, you get into the battle in the spirit and change that physical. Does that make sense? It's very, very important that we understand that this battle is in the spirit. We are going to have to deal with it here. And it has to do with abortion. It has to do with taking the Bible from us. It does have to do with all kinds of things in the physical. But years ago, the Spirit said, we're not protesting in the physical. Our battle is in the spirit. The second thing is you got to realize who you are. Now that you understand that this battle is in the spiritual, you need to realize who you are. Literally, what you are made of. You did not exist before you were born again. I know you're going to say, I looked in the mirror and I'm the same person. The car that you're driving is the same. But what happened was a new person got into this car. See, there was a person that was driving this car around. And when you were born again, a different person started driving this car around. So even though you have the same car, what you are made up is not the same. You are a brand new creation, never existed before, born again. From that day, you are a brand new person. That means you need to understand not just what you're made up of, but also what your genealogy is. See, your genealogy of the person that was in this car has a very specific genealogy that goes back however many years. But the new person that got in here has a genealogy that leads directly to Father God. Because we, that new person that got in there, are B'nai HaElohim. We are direct creations of God because we're born again. Before, we were just born of Adam. Flesh, flesh, done. But when we are born again, that means we are born again of Him. So now, thinking of the battle, thinking of the thing that we can't see, but yet we still got to deal with it in the physical, now you know who you are, what you're made up of. You know your genealogy, who you're connected to. You ever seen something where the name, like there's royalty, the name carries down? Even though, what's the queen's grandbaby? George. What's his name? Oh, Charlotte was the girl, and George. So George, that dude, even though he could probably walk now, but he carries some authority. And he's still walking around in diapers. But that's because of his genealogy. This is what you need to understand. Your genealogy is what gives you that power and that authority. It's because of who your father is. And it's not a matter of, don't make me go get my dad. It's a matter of going, I have been given the power and authority. Jesus said, in my name. And then he gives you a list of things. In my name means in my authority. As if you were me, I want you to go do this. So once you realize that, you realize what your genealogy is, you realize that the changes are coming and you need to be prepared. And you realize that the victory is in Him. It's not in you. Because that in you thinking is the old thinking. Well, that's who I am and I'm just a person and I was born here and I just... No, you realize the victory is in Him. Peter walked on the water because of Him. Peter sank because of Peter. So we go into these challenges, we go into these things that are coming up, knowing who we are. And we say, in Jesus' name, this is what's going to occur, just like Jesus did. Like he expects growth. He expects a certain thing. He walked over to that fig tree. And when he walked over and there was no fruit on it, he cursed it. And then they came back later on, and it was gone. It was dead. I mean, it died way quicker. So when these kind of things occur, this is what we understand. Problem arises, and we go, I'm giving this to God. That's done. And we don't consider it. It's done. It's over. 2017, in all seriousness, is going to move us quickly to ground zero in this spiritual battle. We have got things that are changing so quickly on a prophetic scale. The stuff that we have been reading in Daniel and that we will continue to read, as a matter of fact, the things that are coming up are going to be very relevant. All of these things are starting to play out now. The things that Father God gave to Ezekiel and Isaiah and Daniel and Hosea, all of those things are playing out now, and you're seeing them move very quickly. And watching this stuff, just for example, the fact that we have Syria, Iran, Russia, and Turkey involved in some things with Israel, go back and read Ezekiel 38 and 39. You find out who those people in the play are, you're going to find out it's the same people. So these things that we're seeing playing out, they're playing out now for a very specific reason. That means that the physical challenges are going to be facing us. Physical challenges are going to keep coming because He needs the people that are going to fight in the enemy, needs the people that are going to fight in the spiritual battle to stand down. So he needs to keep you busy with tying your shoelaces together. He needs to keep you busy with throwing mud in your eye. Because if he can keep you busy with little things that has to do with you, you won't get out of yourself and start getting into the spiritual battle with the big picture. You see what I'm saying? If he can get you bothered with a fly flying around your face, you won't pray and get into spiritual battle because you'll be concerned with something here. That's why you need to be very prepared so that when this stuff starts to happen, that you go, done, and move on. As opposed to, oh man, my finances. Oh man, see all the things that could turn into distractions. We need to be able to go, that, done, next, and get into the battle. We need to be keeping the president up. We need to be keeping, I mean, if this guy has any connection to the Bible whatsoever, whether he does or not, let's hold him up. You don't know. If he does, great. If he doesn't, well, then we got what we had before. But at least we can pray for this guy and keep him going. What if we start holding up Benjamin Netanyahu? How do you know that it wouldn't be somebody like our president that maybe talking about the Bible with him or something that causes him to listen finally? You don't think that people have told him about Jesus, the prime minister of Israel? I guarantee they have. They've been trying to tell him Jesus was the Messiah. There's a wall. You can't listen to that. I'm the prime minister of Israel. I can't be that. How do you know it's not somebody, some oddball, out-of-nowhere guy that's going to share something? We don't know. So we start holding these guys up. We start holding up Putin. Maybe he is the one that happens in Ezekiel that causes to happen. Maybe he's not. Maybe he's the one that can try to help the Jews instead of hurt them. We don't know. But as all these things come about, we got to be prepared. We got to prepare for the people around us. If we start doing the spiritual battle over your workplace, what if you started doing spiritual battle over the people in your workplace? Think of that person that drives you the nuts the most. Start with them. You start praying with them first. You say, Father, they drive me crazy. Remember, what's the first thing that you put on? The belt of truth. Father, they drive me nuts. I'm holding them up to you. Show me a way to love them through me. Show me a way that I can move your word forward in a way that it'll be received, not just be a debate. I hold them up. I hold this whole place up. And then do it over wherever you go. You walk into a restaurant, specifically, go up and look at a name tag. Oh, the manager's name is Melissa, okay. And then you go, Father, I hold her up. Start doing battle in the unseen, and you'll see changes in the physical. Go back to that place and see. Keep holding them up. This is what we need to do. And that's when we realize that the victory's all in him. But we do have to hold it up. There's going to be many mental and spiritual challenges, not just physical. Your mind is going to appear at times as though you're going crazy. Am I the only person in that boat? There are times that you're just like, seriously? I've got so much nonsense going on. I got so much, oh my gosh. And really, it's not as bad as the enemy's dreaming it up to be. But yet, inside your head, I got this going and I got that, and all of a sudden, these spiritual battles are something that we go, stop. Father, I receive peace. I receive that rest, and I receive it right now. And as that settles in, all of a sudden, chaos turns into order. And what it seems like is you just burned all the weeds in your yard. And now you can go, oh, no more weeds. But these are the things that are going to be coming. And you've got to be prepared for this. This is not something that I'm saying it might happen or it possibly. I'm telling you, it's going to happen. And you've got to get prepared for it. The spiritual, you have got to just walk the walk. Don't get crazy. Don't get all religious and do this. I'm talking about just simply walk a life that is connected to God. Get into your word and just read. Don't get all, oh man, I'm going to read a chapter a day. I'm going to read a, you know what? Just read. Just read his word. Father, what are we going to read today? And then as you're reading and as you're talking to him, that spiritual bond, it'll be there so tight that you're going to be able to just walk through this and you're preparing yourself. We will stand still and see the salvation of our God. Moses had taken those folks by God's direction out of Egypt. and they had gathered all kinds of stuff, gold, silver, stuff God told them to bring. And they had got out there. And Pharaoh had told them, get out, because the firstborn had just died. So he said, get, just go. As they were leaving, Pharaoh gets real ticked. And he goes, no, go get them. So now the whole army from Pharaoh is chasing them down. They get where there's mountains on both sides and the Red Sea's in front of them. They're boxed in. And the people even started complaining to him. And he goes, they said, what, were there not enough graves back in Egypt? You wanted to bring us out here to die? I mean, think about what was Moses was going on. And Moses turns around and he looks at him and he says, stand still and see the salvation of your God. Shut your yap. Stop complaining. Have faith that God is going to do what he said he's going to do. In their instance, we just saw all these miracles happen. You don't think he's going to show us a miracle? And that's what happened. We do this. We prepare. We are going to be shutting our yap. We are going to be paying attention to what's going on. And we are going to see the salvation of our God. Unmoving. Knowing that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. See, because of who is in me, I'm up to the challenge. I'm ready for this transition of seasons because of who's in me. You guys hear what I'm saying? This is something, and I don't know why, I'm kind of the cynic, I guess, on some things. And when I see things come around where it's going to be a New Year's Day, let's say, and you go, oh, there's going to be a message, you can almost set your watch that the message is going to be something of, okay, old things and new things. And the Holy Spirit just said, no, this is a time of transition. What I want you to tell my people is that we are transitioning from that season to this new season. And this new season is a season of prosperity. This new season is a season of life. This is a season of joy, and it's a season of peace and of rest. But it's in that all of those things are possible when we know who we are and we're walking this out one with God. We know it. Because otherwise, it'll be the opposite of all those things when we're trying to do it on our own. There'll be no peace, there'll be no rest, there'll be nothing, and it won't be prosperity, it'll be lack. So we're going to walk with God. Remember in Psalm 145, I recommend you guys go read 145, the whole chapter. And the whole thing is saying, for the people that call on my name, I shower them with blessings, it said. I shower them with blessings. The only thing he's wanting us to do, like Peter, is call on his name. He knows that this old car is flawed. He knows this thing's all jacked up. But what he also knows is this is not us. The real us is in here. Amen? Can we get ready for 2017? Prepare and know that we're going to walk through that because of who we are? All right. All right. Well, let's...
Thank you for tuning in to the Refuge Church YouTube channel. We pray that you received a word that brings peace to your soul and joy to your heart. In these days that we are living in, chaos is increasing, and it's important to have our hope in the one who brings order, Jesus Christ. Refuge Church is a group of believers who have their hope in God, His Word, and His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We believe that growth occurs in small groups. If you're looking to fellowship with a group like this, you are welcome to join us at Refuge. We are located at 24711 Redlands Boulevard, Suite K in Loma Linda, California, 92354. Our men's Bible study meets on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Our women's Bible study meets on Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. We meet for praise and worship every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. If this message has blessed you and you'd like to link shields with us and support this ministry financially to help continue the work that we do for the kingdom, you can log on to our website at www.refuge-church.com and click the giving button. To access more teaching from the Refuge, log on to our website and click on the audio and video button. These will give you the links to our YouTube channel and to our podcast. We'd be glad if you joined us. Thanks again, and we pray that the Lord blesses you and keeps you as you grow in His Word.